Hey, everybody. Hope you're doing well. As you can see, if you recognize that image, I'm doing a Boston song today. Now, I'm doing my Boston song because I am from that area. I have changed my background for this particular video to display a lot of my sports jerseys. I am sitting here drinking a summer ale by a particular Boston-based beverage company. And that town is my roots, even though I live out here in the LA area now and have for 24 years. There's a reason why I'm doing this song. I'm doing one of their biggest hits, More Than a Feeling. And there's a reason I'm doing it. I felt a need like I wanted to listen to some Brad Delp vocals today. And I bounced around and I looked on YouTube just for kicks. And I noticed a lot of reaction videos to this song, More Than a Feeling. But the reaction videos are all making the same mistake. They're all trying to watch a live performance, but they all pick the official music video for the song More Than a Feeling, which is an actual staged performance video set to a really grainy audio track of the original studio recording that's missing the second verse. So they're not listening to the whole song, and they're not listening to a live performance. Now, the big reason they're not listening to a live performance with Brad Delp is because there really isn't a great live performance with modern technology and modern footage and modern recording quality to give you a great sound. So I'm going to play an example of that. This is a live video. I'm only going to play a little bit of it, but this is a live video from a giant stadium performance, you know, back in 1979. And if you listen to it, I mean, the audio quality on this is terrible, but at least the band is performing live and they're not performing, you know, lip sync to bad original studio audio graininess. Check that out for a few seconds. So there's the first verse. And like I said, it's just 1979 audio. That's what that is. As great as Brad Delp's vocals can be and are, you know, it just doesn't sound even remotely close to as clear as the original audio recording, especially since they remastered it. But the original audio recording is so much more articulate and perfect. And in this particular performance, obviously, Brad isn't singing every vocal part like he did in the studio. So again, it's grainy, it's a live performance, it's you know, it's 44 years old, and it just doesn't sound the way a Boston fan wants this song to sound. It's just not right. I mean, I would have loved to have been there in the audience. I mean, they filled up, you know, giant stadium in 1979. You see a smattering of people in the risers or in the seats behind the stage, but that's backstage. There's 70,000 people in that stadium in front of them. And whoever recorded this, whoever was hired to record this performance, whatever it was, I mean, they were obviously victims of the technology that they had at the time. It's not great audio. The video, I mean, that half of that first verse with the spotlight on Brad had this sun glare in them because it's a daytime concert. And it's just, but it's actually them playing live compared to the, the reaction videos I've seen lately with just a lip-synced, overdubbed, you know, grainy music video that probably was produced in 1978. You know, just, it's not good. So what I want to do now is go on and play the actual remastered studio version with the second verse, which is also missing from the videos that I keep seeing people listen to. And it's just, you know, it's one of those things. I've mentioned it before. There's a wonderful reaction channel that I love called The Charismatic Voice, and she's amazing at her analysis of vocal performances and musical performances. She's really incredible. But she, too, fell victim to the official music video and its horrible sound quality. And she didn't get to hear the second verse in that one, too, so literally lost a minute of the song. And she's not the only one. I've literally today watched a half a dozen reactions that were produced over the course of the last 3 weeks to that official video. And it's just, you're shortchanging. I mean, they all were impressed by what Boston did and how well Brad sang and the notes he hit, so on and so forth. But the audio quality was so terrible. And it's just shortchanging the magnificence of the band Boston. So without further ado, here's the actual remastered audio from the original studio performance, complete with the second verse.
Just start my day, and lost myself.
Now, I will say this. That's one Boston song that I don't listen to too often simply because I had an ex-girlfriend named Marianne. So there's a little bit of a personal twist in there for me. But I never get tired of hearing Brad Delp sing. And, you know, the band Boston was somewhat formed after the album was released. You know, as many of you know, this recording was basically done in Tom Scholl's basement in Waltham, Massachusetts. Tom played pretty much every instrument on this except for the drums and the vocals. The drums, I think he had a couple of different drummers, but his primary drummer was Sib Hashian, who, by the way, was Dwayne The Rock Johnson's father-in-law when Sib passed away a few years ago. And he passed away like many of us musicians wish we could. He passed away literally on stage performing. He was on a cruise ship on one of those rock and roll fantasy tours, but he actually passed away doing what he loved, playing drums. But yeah, Dwayne Johnson, Dwayne The Rock Johnson, married Sib's daughter years ago, and they're still very much married to this day. And so Sib was The Rock's father-in-law. Brad Delp obviously passed away a number of years ago. Depression will take the best of us. It will take any one of us out. And so you've heard me say this in videos before. If you are feeling any kind of potential for self-harm or doubt, what have you, please reach out to friends, reach out to anybody that can help you, a helpline, colleague, your boss, whatever. Reach out to anybody and just try to get that voice, that hand, that helping ear, whatever it is, to just not do something that you can't take back. But Brad's voice is every single voice on this record. All the harmonies, all the background vocals, all the doubled vocals, every piece of vocal is Brad. And there's no auto tune. There's no auto correct. That's perfect singing. Now, by all accounts, Tom Scholl's, was a little bit of a taskmaster when it came to being in the recording studio. He wanted things as perfect as possible. Consider that part of his mad genius, if you will. But he wanted it as I don't know how many takes he made Brad do of each vocal track, but it was a lot. And yet, without that striving for perfection, you probably don't have quite as magical a recording that they couldn't duplicate when they went into a recording studio in L.A. They basically used the original demo tracks for the most part. In the recording process. And people will say the second Boston album, the Don't Look Back album, came out and it wasn't as much of a critical success. It was welcomed and received well, but it wasn't nearly the groundbreaking 17 million plus copy album that the first album was. I think that has a lot to do with the contractual disputes that Boston was in, Tom Scholl's was in with, I think it was CBS Records this was produced on. And so the album was rushed. And it wasn't produced nearly as well. And I think one of the biggest problems with the Don't Look Back album isn't the musicianship. It's the engineering that went on, because the bass in the original release of that, and I have the vinyl over there, the bass isn't nearly as dynamically in the mix as it is on this album. You know, it's buried a little bit and they have to bring it out. I think they remastered it a little bit better, but still it's not quite nearly as present in the mix as the bass was on the original first album. In a way, it's kind of a shame that this band does not get mentioned as often as they should, but if you really think about it, in the first 10 to 15 years of the band's existence, they only released three albums, Boston, Don't Look Back, and Third Stage. And so we really, and again, Brad Delp doesn't get talked about nearly as much as he should as one of the great singers in rock history, because across three albums, there's probably a grand total of 25 songs. that you have for examples of his greatness with the band Boston. And then go back to my earlier statements about the live performance footage. It's just, it's not well recorded. It's not well captured. You know, we can listen to albums from that same time period, like Frampton Comes Alive and Skinner's One More From the Road, One More For the Road, and other live performances. Hell, even Pink Floyd's Live in Pompeii. You know, you can hear the Woodstock album. You can hear better performances, better recordings. And the Boston live performances just weren't recorded nearly as well back in that time period. And I don't know why. I can't explain it. But so you have less material to draw from when comping Brad Delp to any other singer. So it's clearly obvious why. In many instances, you know, you would definitely hold Freddie Mercury or Steve Perry or Ronnie James Dio or you know, any of the great vocalists, Rob Halford, above Brad Delp. But on the other side of that, you know, fewer albums with greater vocals isn't necessarily a thing that should be a knock against Brad Delp. Excuse me. His voice was, I mean, virtual perfection on these records. And I think that's why it bothers me as much as anything about people on YouTube reacting to poor audio quality recordings of this majestic voice and this incredible sounding group or this incredible sounding recording. It's just, it's like you're sitting back and you're just shortchanging the entire band, the entire group, the entire recording process, just because you want to watch video footage of people singing, thinking that it's, maybe you're thinking that it's going to draw eyes in because there's motion on the screen or whatever it is. Let's face it, if the audio is terrible, you're not going to get quite the effect and response as you would with clear audio, even without motion in the video. And so I just, and then again, drives me crazy. The second verse is missing from that official audio, from that official music video. They cut the second verse to lower the length of the song to under 5 minutes, down to under 4 minutes. And it's just kind of a tragedy because that second verse is absolutely, absolutely fantastic. And to me, if you pull out the second verse, you take away a significant amount of the meaning of the song. You know, it's kind of like, I mean, just imagine if you were sitting there, I don't know, reading some Shakespeare or reading, you know, a legendary book like The Great Gatsby or something like that. And you were only going to put in the first and second chapter and the last chapter and the next to last chapter, but you're going to take out all the chapters in the middle. You know, you're reading a poem and you're going to read the first stanza of the poem and the last stanza of the poem, and you're not going to read the rest of the poem. You know, it's like you're missing something when you do that. And I wanted to hear the entire song. So I've gone on long enough. Please feel free to leave a comment in the comment section below. We can talk about it further if you'd like to. And just know that I truly appreciate you and I wish you all well. Okay? Cheers.